Entity Framework Core does not require primitive types. If you keep designing anemic models, then it's time to admit. It's always been your fault. I will now show you a demo where EF Core works with a rich object-oriented model with no trouble. All fields in this model of a book are strings, like the title, language of the title, language of the book, and the optional ISBN, which is a nullable string. This domain model exhibits primitive obsession. Let me show you the database. I'm querying the books table. You can see the data about a handful of books. Each has a title, a title's language, the book's language, and the ISBN. This is fine. The database should only contain plain data. But now many programmers believe that the model must also consist of primitive types just because they used Entity Framework Core in their application. That causes numerous issues. How does the model defend from an invalid state? The two static factory methods perform major work. One creates a new instance and the other one instantiates a pre-existing entity. The latter method receives an identity. That is the difference. We cannot tell whether these arguments are valid. We should at least fail if the title is null or white space. This static helper method throws on error but returns a valid string on success. It will be easy to use, as you will see in a moment. The second validation method would check the culture name. The getCultureInfo static method will throw if the culture name is not recognized. Upon success, the method returns the well-formatted culture name. So this method is both validation and input sanitization. The third validation method would check the ISBN. I will only support one format, which consists of 13 digits. My work in this class is far from done, and it tempts my patience already. Oh, how I will celebrate when I delete all this code. The static factory methods will transparently pass each argument through the corresponding validation primitive. While I fix the second factory method, ask yourself if it was really the EF Core that made me suffer so dearly. Or was it just an excuse for not doing the object design? It took me 60 lines of code to only declare and populate the state. But that is only one half of the code I needed to write. The other half is at the endpoint, which is creating the book instance. This endpoint in the minimal API application handles the post HTTP request and creates a new book in the database. It already contains a lot of validation, which is clearly a duplicate logic. Let me turn all those validation methods public so that I can at least reuse them. I will rewrite the validation in the handler to use those methods. Here is how that works. If the book validation throws, we add a field validation error. If there are validation errors after all the checks, we report them back immediately. If there were no errors, we construct a new book instance and persist it in the database. I really dislike this code, even though I have reused the validation from the book model. Now I've got my anemic domain model. There are dozens of other videos on this channel that discuss the reasons and methods to avoid anemic domain models. This video is about using EF Core. Assuming you also want to use proper objects, I will now show you how you combine them with Entity Framework Core. The goal is to keep primitive data in the database table while using proper objects in the application. Let's begin with a simple example of ISBN. It is just a string here, but it doesn't have to be. Why not design a class named ISBN? It will encapsulate the data but also validate them. Once we change the string into a strongly typed ISBN class, everything else is on the EF Core to manage. For one thing, we need a mapping between the ISBN class and the varchar field in the database. An easy way to accomplish that in EF Core is to supply a custom value converter. This one would convert a nullable ISBN into a nullable string. It is easy to implement. Just supply the mapping expressions. Given an ISBN, the result is either a null string or the value from inside that object. Given a string, the corresponding ISBN is either null or the new instance. We configure the book entity next so that it maps its ISBN property. the property has a conversion using the nullable ISBN converter object. It is critical to understand that this change does not require a new migration. The database schema remains the same, even though we have enriched the domain model to stop using strings and start using objects. I have fixed the two static factory methods, and with that I find that this class is no longer using this validation method. I told you I would be deleting these methods. The constructors will also operate on the strongly typed ISBN class. The book model is already a little bit more object-oriented than it used to be. I have made changes in all other layers of the application. Introducing objects is easy. Just follow the traces of red color and fix the compile time errors. I can remove other strings in the model too. Before that, let me remind you that you can download this entire source code from my Patreon page. Patrons are the reason why this channel is free. If you become a patron, you will help hundreds of other fellow programmers watch more than 100 videos on my channel for free. Now, the strings. Why use strings when there is the CultureInfo class that manages cultures in .NET? With passing the strongly typed CultureInfo through the factory methods, another validation method goes to dust. Fix the constructors and the model is complete again. I have made the corresponding changes in all other places. That brings us back to the book configuration in EF Core again. Introduce a new CultureInfo converter which persists the culture name in the database. It would then construct the CultureInfo object back from the culture name. This mapping is all we need to stop working with strings while in fact implementing internationalization. Then simply specify that both fields should be converted using this new converter and the whole application will work once again. This is another change that will not require any migrations, remember that. The database schema remains the same, but the book domain model will use objects from now on. The last case I want to cover regards these two properties. The title and the title culture always come together. Why are they the two separate properties then? I want this data clump to become a concept of its own. Start by giving it a class. Add one and the other property. Set them through the constructor. Validate the arguments. The class is complete and it covers one important responsibility: holding the title and its language information together in one place. Back in the domain model, use the complex object instead of two simple ones. This is one routine refactoring in object-oriented design. You will see that EF Core will not stand in the way. The change in the static factory methods follows, along with removing the title validation. This operation now belongs in the book title class. Fixing all the other parts of the application is straightforward too. Just follow the compile time errors and everything should work fine. That brings us to configuring the book entity again. The string title used to be mapped automatically. The title culture required a conversion. This time we want to map the title property as a whole. EF Core uses complex property configuration for that. A complex property allows for setting up the details about its own properties. You can tell that the value property has the column name title in the database. The property culture has the column name title culture in the database plus the conversion using the CultureInfo converter. Once again, I have changed the domain model, but I don't need to create a migration to make it work. The database schema has remained the same throughout this entire video. There is a tiny change we must perform in the private constructor. EF Core does not feed complex properties through the constructor, but through the property setters. Title and release are the complex properties which this constructor does not initialize. The other constructor will not pass the title down, but set it through the property setter on its own. From this point on, I can harvest all the benefits of object-oriented design in this class, such as using optional objects and the result type or implementing domain operations in the appropriate classes. Watch my other videos to improve on those techniques. This video was meant to demonstrate that EF Core will not stand in your way. It supports rich mappings that work transparently. You can write these objects to the database and query by those objects later. You can do whatever you need and still retain objects all the way through in the domain model. Do not use Entity Framework as an excuse for not doing object-oriented design.